back to Talk with Gaetano. Thank you so much for keeping it on Urban Television. We do appreciate being in your living rooms right here on Urban Television. Let's get back to our guest this evening, Cissy Kagaba, who is the executive director. We have so many executive directors.
I know,
of the Anti-Corruption Coalition of Uganda. And we're going to find out who she is, what she's about. And she still refused to tell me how tall she is because she's never measured herself. Unbelievable. Anyway, let's move on. What have been some of the highlights during your work, be it when you were leaving the Law Development Center, your first job? What have been some of the key highlights in your career?
I think one is when you join an organization and you're able to see it grow. I think for me that is key. And of course, the other issue, so one of the highlights is, of course, increasing at times the donor funding, because you see, most of actually all the NGOs rely on donor funding. And like I said, one of the reasons as to why I didn't really want to take up the position was because of some of the challenges that I saw. And I was just thinking that, I mean, this is too much. I don't really think I can take it on. So if you're able to maneuver and to overcome, you know, the challenges, issues relating to the visibility of the organization, issues relating to staffing, issues relating to the funding. Of course, it takes a lot of work and takes a lot of teamwork, but I think for me, it's one of those. And of course, the other is when you're able to advocate for particular things and you see them come to pass. I think for me it is, because at times it isn't just a matter of coming out and you talk and you talk and you talk. But I think the fact that you're able to see particular change. Of course, people at times say, well, you guys, you're speaking and talking, but there's no change. But trust me, there's a lot of change that has actually happened. Of course, it may not really be so much at the national level or something like that, but at times when you go down to the grassroots and you're dealing with the local, rural, poor people, and you're engaging with various government agencies, and you see them take on your recommendations and actually implement. And at times it is totally different when people say that government doesn't act. By the way, government, at the local government, government does take up certain recommendations. Even at the national level, being able to see government take on particular recommendations. So for me, it moves away from the bigger picture by people say that, well, guys, you're speaking and speaking, this government doesn't change, this government doesn't. But I've actually seen situations whereby we've been able to see government officials change. We've been able to see some, been able to influence particular government policies, and government has listened. Of course, obviously, it may not really be, not everything is going to be taken on board. But I think when you're able to see some of those changes that you actually thought you wouldn't be able to see, and especially when you're in an environment whereby people are saying, yeah, you guys can talk and talk and talk and talk, nothing is going to change, but in there something happens.
Okay, so if you were to give maybe a grade, let's say a grade out of 100%, what would be the grade for the Anti-Corruption Coalition of Uganda? If you were to look at, you know, because you're saying some policies go through, some don't. You know, if you were to give yourself a grade, okay, if you were to give you a grade throughout your career, even with the Anti-Corruption Coalition, what would that grade be?
Probably 70%.
70%? That's pretty high.
Now, 70% based on where we were and where we are now, 70% on what I see has been able to be done, 70% on some of the new networks that we've been able to actually to form. Because at times it isn't only about some of the work that you do, but how have you been able to spread? How have you been able to? I think for us, what we look out more is the local person, having quite a number of people get on board. So I think that, of course, there may be some other clawbacks, just like in any, but you see, if you're looking at how far you've been able to reach, which we've been able to bring on board, which networks, the stability. So for me, that I could give it at that rate.
About 70%.
Yeah.
All right, let's take a look at perhaps going back to women. In your way to build capacity for women, for example, what has been the biggest challenge that you have faced in that role?
I think women, you know, we live in a patriarchal society.
Yes, we do.
And you see, the way we are brought up is so much of a patriarchal way. So you need to change the mindset when you're going to deal with women. Because I think in most cases, what people fail to understand is when you start at this level and people already, I mean, there are things that you can, I mean, it's like culture, there are particular culture things that you're not going to tell a person, just wash them away.
Yes, yes.
So even dealing with women at times, it's how can a person know that they're able to do it despite the fact that they are women? How are they able to understand that, I mean, despite everything, I can speak out. But again, also at times women tend to pull each other down. So even whereby you would have been able to build, there's this whole issue of pulling, you know, pulling each other down. And that, of course, doesn't really help us as women, because if you're going to continuously pull other women down other than us building each other, it's a bit of a challenge. Though, of course, I know that there are particular women that have actually come up and they've actually tried to build other women. Mm. But I think for me, the challenge that I see is that whole patriarchal thing, thinking I cannot talk out, I cannot challenge a man. You see, there's this whole issue by the law provides for gender. And yeah, and the whole percentage that, okay, every probably local government should have like this percentage of women. But also you realize that even when women come and sit in these meetings, they actually won't talk. I mean, okay, you've made your law, fine, and maybe you're having three quarters or whichever third, the women come in and sit. But you see, they'll still not talk. And even if they spoke, the guys will not actually take on their recommendations. Mm. So I think, how does a person get rid of that mindset to know that I can still talk? Mm. And the other issue is mentoring, because few women are mentored. I mean, I also wasn't mentored. I mean, okay, I have few that I could look out to, some women that have really mentored me, but it isn't that easy. There's that whole thing that I'm a woman, this I cannot do, this I can do. And some of them will fear to be challenged. The moment a guy gets up and speaks and challenges you, how many are willing to take them on, despite the fact that you're a guy? So, okay, fine, let us roll, let us go on and on and on. So I think for me, it is the society, and it is the confidence, and it is the mentoring for women to ensure that someone is able to send, and to avoid the whole issue of pulling each other down, because it's one of the challenges.
One of the biggest challenges. Yeah. Let's talk about the Anti-Corruption Coalition of Uganda. You are now the executive director of this organization. It must have taken quite a lot to get there. I mean, you have to be recognized. There has to be something in you for people to say, we would like you to take this position, or for yourself to say, I am going to go for this position. What was it like? What did you have to go through to get that seat?
No, well, of course, they opened up. I applied, and one of the board members told me, yeah, you see, not only are you a woman, but you look young, so are you going to manage? And of course, I was replacing a guy, and I was thinking, okay, I really have very big shoes. I mean, one, of course, you need to pray and pray and pray, you know, that, because I realized, one of the things I realized was that there are particular attributes I needed to build. Because the other issue is you need to know what are some of those weaknesses that are actually going to act as a hindrance.
Right.
So I think I knew that I needed to work on A, B, C, D. Of course, it took me quite some time. And just remember, you're in an organization at times where there are men. So it also becomes, there are some of those dynamics that come in by the guys, and then you're a woman, and then you've been there. So, but I think for me, it's how confident you are. But the issue is realizing that, okay, I have a weakness in this area. How am I able to overcome it?
And has this position ever been, and you'd be telling me, because I don't know, has this position as the executive director of the coalition ever been filled by a woman?
I think the ones that I know have been guys. I think maybe there was a lady, I don't know. I think upon inception, I think there have been guys.
Mostly men?
Yes, mostly men, So, but again, you like just like most organizations, there's that whole thing. I mean, you have a board, by then the board is probably filled with men. It's the whole thinking has to be about guys and stuff. So, I mean, you need to know your stuff in order for you to convince the board to ensure that they're going to give you this position. So, I mean, I think for me it was the courage, saying, okay, fine. I was a bit conflicted because, like I said, I had to apply on the last day. But I think I had to first convince myself, okay, fine, I think I can do it, I can do it. You know, just continue affirming particular things in your life and think, okay, fine, I can do it. So by the time you come for the interview, these are the fact that you're fearing. You have to be very convincing, and they're saying, okay, yeah, fine, I think the person.
So obviously, when the position came up, there were many people who vied for it, I would say a couple of people vied for it, and you came out on top. What do you think they saw in you that they did not see in others? What was the X factor that you brought?
I can't really tell, because I know there were quite a number of other guys, but I think maybe I convinced them, and maybe probably had been there, and I also knew some of the challenges that the organization was going through. So of course, the moment I applied, I knew these are the challenges, this is what I need to share with the board, and this is what I intend to do the moment I'm taken on. But then also, I don't know, but I think for me it was, I'd been there before, and I had a clear strategy of what I needed to see being done. But then I was also able to recognize that these are the challenges that the organization is facing, and this is what I think needs to be done. That's what I could say.
How long is the term of the executive director?
It's 3 years, but it can be renewed.
It can be renewed?
Yes.
Okay. Don't. So how many years, how many terms do you want to have?
You know this whole thing. So if guys still want me, then I'm going to continue being there, so we shall keep going.
So if the people want you to stay, you will stay.
Obviously. No, but obviously, you know, there comes a time when you really need to go. And it's one of the things I'm, yeah. Really, I mean, you can't really be in particular organizations forever. So there has to come a time when, obviously, and not very far.
Okay, yeah. This is a position, obviously, a lot of work, a lot of reading. You've got to, you know, talk to the press quite often to let them know what you found out, what's going on, to follow up on things that you said you need to see changed and likes. I'll come back to the organization, but in terms of your personal life, this is quite a serious position. Do you ever fear for your life?
Obviously, yes. There are particular, you know, one of the things we do as an organization, do investigative journalism. And you get people who are going to go underground and they'll bring you particular information and you'll actually weigh and say, I just can't bring out this information. If I brought it out, it's going to be disaster.
So there are times when you have said, I am not going to touch this.
I mean, yeah, we have quite a lot of reports that and you see, there are very many people in government that are actually willing to give you information. Inside communication, you'll get the information and say, okay, fine. Because you also need to understand the terrain under which you are working in. So yes, when you fear for your life, this particular information, you're just either going to shelve or you may need to think of other strategies of bringing it out. And trust me, the information is there. You always get that information. But
it has to be credible information.
No, by the way, it is.
Credible.
Yes, I can assure it is credible information with documentation. You see, like I said, there are people in government who will give you this information. They will tell you, I'm giving you this information, but you haven't seen me, you haven't gotten it from me, but when you check, the documentation is authentic. But then you need to sit back and say, okay, fine, if I bring it out. And of course, some of this information, if you really bring it out, it's going to cause a lot of public outrage. But you need to think of the personalities that are involved. What type of protection do you have? Because also you need to understand that, yeah, much as you're doing this work, you have a life. So there is particular information that you get well documented. I mean, it shows you a trail of what exactly has happened. And you're thinking, okay, I think for this, let me just put it aside.
Really?
Yeah, trust me, yes, there's a lot of information that we shall get. But you need to be wise and know the timing where you're going to have to release this information. So at times we want to partner, what we want to do, because we realize the information is there. What if we could partner with some of the journalists out of the country? So that probably when you give them this information, it won't actually have to come back to you.
I see.
I mean, we haven't yet done it, but one of the things that we're trying to think about, because at the end of the day, you may... I mean, this particular information we have, and even the local journalists themselves will fear to touch it.
Really?
Yeah, trust me, there's information I haven't. Okay, guys, that one, no, we can't. So if they can't, then what are you going to do? But again, also, as an organization, you need to understand that this particular information you can bring out, and this particular information, at a particular point, you can hold on to that information. And of course, when I say hold on to that, we may not have it at our office, in our offices. Obviously, you need to back it up and put it somewhere. Because when our offices were broken into, we realized that it's not, I mean, you can't just have information within your offices. So at times, you need to back it up, you photocopy.
Backups after backup after backup.
Obviously.
Photocopies were,
exactly, yeah. Because, I mean, this is information today. But at times, in most cases, a person won't even know what type of information it is. So you keep it, and then you could even wait for years before you release it. Because I think also timing of particular information is actually very, very key. So fearing for your life, yes, obviously, yes. I think
has anything ever happened to you and you've gone, has anything physically ever happened to you?
Not really, but there's some of the work that you'll do and someone will call you and say, actually, now this and this happened because this and this told me this, that if you're not careful, sometimes you get people who are actually going to warn you. So there's some of those, I mean, some of the, I won't really mention, but you see, there's some of those, so whereby a person tell you, actually, yeah, this happened because, you did this and this and this, so someone is so I mean, some of those will happen, obviously, yeah. So your attempts need to be very, very,
very
cautious. Yeah,
all right. We want to go for a very short break, Cissy. When we come back, I want to go a little deeper into the Anti-Corruption Coalition of Uganda, perhaps touch on a few things that have been happening in Uganda. Just get your personal viewpoint. Maybe you can share with us your thoughts on that. Cissy Kagaba is in the studio. We're talking about her life, who she is. Maybe she'll tell us, is she married? Does she have children? Does she have somebody in her life? We'll find out more from the short, strong woman here on Talk with Gaetano.